first, a child, photograph you might call it, shows him about the age of 10, a small boy surrounded by a great many women, his sisters and cousins no doubt. He stands in brightly checked trousers by the edge of a garden pond. His head is tilted at an angle 30 degrees to the left, and his teeth are bared in an ugly smirk. Ugly, you may well question the word for insensitive people. That is to say, those indifferent to matters of beauty and ugliness, what mechanically common with a bland, vicious, vacuous expression. What an adorable little boy. It is quite true, though what commonly passes for adorable is sufficiently present in this child's face to give a modicum of meaning to the compliment. But I think that anyone who had ever been subjected to the least exposure to what makes for beauty would most likely toss the photograph to one side with a gesture employed in brushing away a caterpillar and mutter in profound revulsion, "What a dreadful child." Indeed, the more carefully you examine the child's smiling face, the more you feel an indescribable, unspeakable horror creeping over you. You see that it is actually not a smiling face at all. The boy has not a suggestion of a smile. Look at his tightly clenched fists if you want proof. No human being can smile with his fists doubled like that. It is a monkey, a grinning monkey face. The smile is nothing more than a puckering of ugly wrinkles. The photograph reproduces an expression so freakish and at the same time so unclean and even nauseating that your impulse is to say, "What a wizened, hideous little boy." I have never seen a child with such an unaccountable expression. The face in the second snapshot is startling, unlike the first. He is a student in this picture, although it is not clear whether it dates from high school or college days. At any rate, he is now extraordinarily handsome. But here again, the face fails inexplicably to give the impression of belonging to a living human being. He wears a student's uniform, and a white handkerchief peeps from his breast pocket. He sits in a wicker chair with his legs crossed. Again, he is smiling, this time not the wizened monkey's grin, but a rather adroit little slime. And yet somehow it is not the smile of a human being. It utterly lacks substance, all of what we might call the heaviness of blood, or perhaps the solidity of human life. It has not even a bird's weight. It is merely a blank sheet of paper, light as a feather, and it is smiling. The picture produces, in short, a sensation of complete artificiality. Pretense, insincerity, fetishiousness, none of these words quite covers it. And of course, you couldn't dismiss it simply as dandyism. In fact, if you look at it carefully, you would begin to feel that there is something strangely unpleasant about this handsome young man. I have never seen a young man whose good looks were so baffling. The remaining photograph is the most monstrous of all. It is quite impossible in this one even to guess the age, though the hair seems to be streaked somewhat with gray. It was taken in a corner of an extraordinarily dirty room. You can plainly see in the picture how the wall is crumbling in three places. His small hands are held in front of him. This time, he is not smiling. There is no expression whatsoever. The picture has a genuinely chilling, foreboding quality, as if it caught him in the act of dying. As he sat before the camera, his hands held over a heater. That is not the only shocking thing about it. Extravagant dishes. So. house was packed. Everybody in town who was especially friendly to my father was present and enthusiastically applauding. When the speech was over, the audience filtered out in threes and fives into the night. As they set out for home on the snow-covered roads, they were scathingly commenting on the meeting. I could distinguish among the voices those of my father's closest friends, opening remarks had been, and how difficult it was to make head or tail of the great man's address. Then these men stopped by my house, went into our parlor, and told my father with expression of genuine delight on their faces what a great success the meeting had been. Even the servants, when asked by my mother about the meeting, answered as if it were their spontaneous thought that it had been really interesting. These were the self-same servants who had been bitterly complaining on the way home that political meetings are the most boring thing in the world. This, however, is only a minor example. I am convinced the human life is filled with many pure, happy, serene examples of insincerity, truly splendid of their kind, of people deceiving one another without, strangely enough, any wounds being inflicted, of people who seem deceiving one another. But I have no special interest in instances of mutual deception. I myself spend a whole day long deceiving human beings with my clowning. I have not been able to work up much concern over the morality prescribed in textbooks of ethics under such names as righteousness. I find it difficult to understand the kind of human being who lives, or who is sure he can live purely, happily, serenely, in the scene. Human beings never did teach me that abstruse secret. If I had only known that one thing, I should never have had to dread a human being so, nor should I have opposed myself to human life, nor tasted such torments of hell every night. In short, I believe that the reason why I did not tell anyone about the loathsome crime perpetrated on me by the servants was not because of distrust for